We have to now discuss different parts of atmosphere. So we are discussing more clearly the atmosphere part over here. Now atmosphere is not uniform. Let us check out. So this is the Earth's surface. Suppose we are saying this portion is Earth's surface, then atmosphere is spread from Earth's surface towards the space side. But the density is different. Say for example, earlier density is very high. As we are moving at higher altitude, density of atmosphere decreases slowly. The temperature is also not constant throughout the atmosphere. And so we are calling this part as atmosphere, that is not same throughout the world. Now we are considering this in different layers. So first layer, first type of division we are saying, that is homosphere and heterosphere. As name indicates, the homosphere is having similar condition. The chemical composition is similar, whereas heterosphere is having different condition. Homosphere is further divided into three parts, that is called as troposphere, stratosphere and mesosphere. So three spheres we have to consider here as homogeneous sphere, that is troposphere, stratosphere and mesosphere. The fourth one, that ionosphere, that is not a part of homosphere, that is part of heterosphere. Let us describe first homosphere. Out of that, the first part we are going to discuss, that is troposphere. Now I must zoom over here, so just check out the graph first. Now the first, on x-axis we are considering temperatures, whereas on y-axis we are considering distance from Earth's surface in terms of kilometers. So our y-axis is having kilometer wise data, 20, 40, 60, 80 and 100 and plus, whereas here we are considering temperature ranges. But keep in mind, our graph is not starting at 0, 0. Origin, no, this is the zero temperature. I am marking here. So our graph is not starting at zero temperature. We have to consider negative temperatures towards greater extent. Now, first part we are considering, that is troposphere. We are calling the troposphere is around 8 to 16 kilometers from Earth's surface. Now keep in mind that whenever we are calling Earth's surface, means we have to consider here sea level rather. So the height of troposphere is from 8 to 16 kilometer. The 8 kilometer height you can express, you can expect from the polar region. So suppose this is the part of Earth we are considering, then in polar region we are getting the height as 8 kilometer, and from that till equatorial region height slowly increases till 16 kilometers. Means that must be very clear for you, that whenever we are discussing about troposphere, the height is not constant. It ranges from 8 kilometer to 16 kilometer on polar side, that means on North Pole and South Pole we can expect that as 8 kilometer, whereas on equatorial side we can expect that as 16 kilometer in height. So suppose we are considering for India, we can consider that it is less than 16 kilometer but greater than definitely 8 kilometer in height. And so if question is asked, Mount Everest is there in troposphere or not, for the reason is that it is not at 90 degree and therefore it must be there in the part of troposphere only. Now characteristic of troposphere is something different. Say whatever we are calling the atmospheric events, the maximum atmospheric events are taking place in troposphere. Say what is atmospheric event? Even we are calling the cyclones, the cyclones are taking place in this part. Different, say, monsoon, as we had discussed about monsoon, the monsoon clouds, then precipitations, all that, they are taking place in troposphere. In troposphere, there is presence of water vapors and dust particles. Keep in mind, if you are moving the height which is greater than 16 kilometers, that will be free from dust particle and as well as free from water vapors. So here, it is very clear for us that water vapors are present only in the troposphere part. This is important characteristic. Then dust particles are present only in the troposphere part. They are absent in higher parts. The third important thing, that whatever the events are taking place in atmosphere, we are calling that as atmospheric event. These atmospheric events, they are taking place in this troposphere. In the troposphere, as we are moving away from the surface of Earth, the temperature starts decreasing. For every 160 meter, in some book it is given as 165 meter, for every 160 meter, the temperature fall is by 1 degree Celsius. So keep in mind, this is called as lapse rate. The lapse rate of temperature is, for every 160 meter, temperature falls by 1 degree Celsius. Let us check out, if you are considering some example, let us take example of Mahabaleshwar, a famous hill station in Maharashtra. The Mahabaleshwar is having height as 1438 meter. Consider that approximately equal to 1600 meter. I'm not saying exactly, but approximately equal to 1600 meter. The place at foothills, that is named as Mahar, Polapur, these places are almost at sea level, whereas Mahabaleshwar is having approximate height of 1600 meter. So water temperature is found in Mahabaleshwar, that is definitely 10 degrees less than temperature obtained in the best cities like Mahad and Polapur. You can check out this always. That's why this station, this is famous hill station for particularly pleasant climate. Say 1600 meter is height, divided by 160. So you are getting answer as 10. So fall is of 10 degree, or you can say this way, that for 160 meter fall is by 1 degree. So for 1600 meter fall is by dash dash degree. Check out cross multiplication, you will get answer as 10. And so, as we are going at higher altitude on Earth, especially in troposphere region, we are getting less temperature. The decrease in temperature is 160 meter. For every 160 meter, it decreases by 1 degree Celsius. This is called as lapse rate. Obviously, this lapse rate is not constant throughout the troposphere. It varies from polar region to equatorial region, and that's why the equatorial temperature of troposphere, that is in the range of minus 80 degrees Celsius, whereas polar temperature of troposphere is just around minus 50 degrees Celsius. So, on surface, poles are much, much more cooler than equator. But in troposphere, the extreme of troposphere, the temperature of equator is less, and temperature at polar region is more, because on polar region we are getting temperature as minus 50, whereas here we are getting temperature as minus 80 degrees Celsius. The troposphere is a part of atmosphere which is most studied, and therefore we are having considerable great knowledge about troposphere. Then the second one, that is about stratosphere, and then about mesosphere. We have very less knowledge about ionosphere. I'm not saying not there, but comparatively we have less knowledge about ionosphere. So let us now discuss. First thing, can you imagine that there should be snowfall on equator?
Is it possible that snowfall on equator? Answer is yes. How? We have to move 160 meter higher altitude. The temperature fall will be there around 1 degree Celsius. Just imagine the average temperature at equator is 30 degrees. So 160 meter, that means 1 degree fall. So just try to calculate that 160 into 30. Why into 30? Because average temperature we are considering as 30. And we have to find out where we will get practically zero temperature. So for 1 degree fall, we have to go at height of 160 meter. So for 30 degree fall, we have to multiply this by 160. I am keeping two zeros, 16 threes are 48. So height is 4800 meter. That means 4.8 kilometer approximately. If you are having height as 5000 meter on equator, then you can expect snowfall over there. The only place in the world that is Kilimanjaro in Africa that is having this place, that snowfall around equator you can practically find over here. Now another characteristic of troposphere, that because of dust particles present in troposphere, the precipitation of water is enhanced to greater extent. So dust particles are responsible for scattering of light. Dust particles are responsible for precipitation of water in form of rain or say hailstone, whatever that. Now we are not having any distinct boundaries. Like in case of nation, we have distinct boundaries. Many boundaries in the nations, they are distinct. So here we are not having distinct boundaries. So between troposphere and next sphere, that is called as stratosphere. So between troposphere and stratosphere, there is a point that we are calling as tropopause. Now from here we find that as we are moving at higher altitude, the temperature decreases and one can expect approximately around minus 30 temperature. No doubt this is not perfect. Altitude wise and latitude wise temperature is different, but negative temperatures are possible in troposphere. The in-between layer between troposphere and stratosphere, that is called as tropopause, where you can expect almost constant temperature. No, no, we are considering something average, that's why this line is around 60. But you are aware that in polar region this line can be there in range of minus 50, and on equator this line can be on range of minus 80 also. Now in tropopause the change in temperature is not taking place. Henceforth we are having next layer, that is called as stratosphere. Now stratosphere is up till height of 50 kilometer. So first part troposphere, that is under height of 16 kilometer, but henceforth we are having 50 kilometer height, we are having stratosphere. Now keep in mind, in case of troposphere, temperature changes with altitude, altitude means height from sea level, as well as latitude. That means suppose you are on polar region, temperature is less. You are on equator, temperature is high. So latitude wise as well as altitude wise there is change in temperature. But that event also taking place only in troposphere. If you are talking of stratosphere, then it is latitude independent, whereas it is altitude dependent. So as height increases, we are getting rising temperature. So stratosphere is having different temperature condition than troposphere. Now reasons we have to find out, but in next part of the lecture, in the same lecture we are going to find out reason, but not right now, but in the next part. So stratosphere, that is having increasing temperature, and temperature can increase till 0 degree Celsius or in the vicinity of 0 degree Celsius. till height of 50 km from surface. Now, what is the characteristic of stratosphere? The first characteristic of stratosphere, that is, there is absence of water vapors and dust particles over here. Then this is comparatively calm region. Clouds, storms, whatever the thing, they are not there in this. So this is ideal region for plane, like jet plane to drive here. So this is ideal region if you are able to traveling in this. Then air resistance is also comparatively very less, and winds etc. are not that much effective in this region. Now, second thing, and that is very important, that here ultraviolet rays are absorbed because ozone layers are present above 16 kilometers, particularly in range of 22 kilometer height. The ozone density is very high, and this ozone is responsible for absorption of ultraviolet rays. Keep in mind, not all ultraviolet rays are absorbed here. Only harmful ultraviolet rays, they are absorbed over here by ozone. Try to recollect our chemistry lectures. Then we have discussed about spectroscopy. The particular wavelength is absorbed by particular element. So here ozone layer is absorbing particular wavelength of ultraviolet rays. These ultraviolet radiations are harmful. Now, as radiations are absorbed, that is energy is absorbed, there is rising temperature. And this is the reason, one of the reason that here temperature rises as we are moving at higher the altitude. That means suppose I am constructing a tower, not possible yet, or suppose I am constructing a tower which is having height in the range of 16 km, then I can get very less temperature. But suppose I am increasing the height of that tower till 50 km from Earth's surface, I will get that temperature again increases till here. The layer is there that is called as stratopods. Same way as we are discussing this, this tropopods. So here we are considering stratopods. Now, in stratopods layer, we are having similar temperature condition as there in case of stratosphere. So no much rise and fall in the temperature is taking place over here. Now this region of mesosphere and stratosphere, in between that we are having a region that is called as stratosphere. The part where ozone layers are there, they are called as ozonosphere also. Why it is called as ozonosphere? Because ozone concentration is towards greatest extent in this particular region. So this is called as ozonosphere. Now, in case of mesosphere, we are having fall in temperature. Mesosphere is there from 50 kilometers to 80 kilometers in height. You can expect fall of temperature in this particular region, and at height of 80 kilometers, temperature falls in range of minus 100 degrees Celsius. So this is very, very important thing. Many time questions can be asked, and especially if you want to make trap, then questions can be asked like this way. What is the coldest place on Earth? We are not mentioning surface. We are mentioning coldest place on Earth. And at that time, we can give option North Pole, South Pole, Kilimanjaro, none of these. And here, the expected answer is none of these. Why it is none of these? Because the coldest place here, that is around minus 100 degrees Celsius, which is in range of 80 kilometers above Earth's surface. But still, atmosphere is there. Atmosphere is part of Earth only. And so, on Earth, if you are asking, then that is the answer as mesosphere. The higher altitude of mesospheres are cold, but there is no particular place universally, throughout the world we are getting same temperature, because only latitude dependent part is troposphere, henceforth part is not latitude dependent. So in case of mesosphere, we are getting fall in temperature till 80 km, the atmosphere become more and more rare. And then there is mesopause, a small region between mesosphere and ionosphere. The next, about 80 km, till theoretically we can say a very high altitude, but practically in range of 600 km. It is not mentioned over here, but till 600 km we can say there is continuously rising temperature. So temperature rises from minus 100 degree Celsius and increases, and even in certain part we are getting temperature as 1400 degree Celsius. Keep in mind, hottest place on earth, again, that is the upper part of ionosphere, that is called as thermosphere. This is important thing. Now these ions are present. You are aware, what is ion? If electron is lost or gained, but here answer is lost, from atom, then ions are produced. For more detailed discussion, just refer out our initial basic chemistry lectures. There we have discussed about what is atom and what is ion, especially periodic table lectures where we have discussed about ionization potential. So here energy supplied is so high that atoms are existing in form of ions, and this is called as ionosphere. Now this ionosphere part is very very important from radio communication point of view, as they are charged particles, they are reflecting back radio waves from earth surface. So suppose we are making a radio station and different frequencies of radio waves are sent, then they get reflected back by ionosphere and sent back to earth surface. Therefore we can use radio waves for communication. So this is important part of ionosphere, where temperature rises constantly. This is probably because of absorption of cosmic rays coming from outer part of atmosphere. So they get absorbed over here. Then second thing, this portion is responsible for burning out meteorites, or say whatever the dust that is coming out from space in the Earth's atmosphere, that is burned. The ignition process taking place in this part of ionosphere, and then we can observe that like falling star, but this is not actually falling star. The stone is ignited and that fire stone is now coming towards Earth's surface. If that is small enough, it can be burnt in upper parts of atmosphere only. If it is large enough that after burning also it can hit the Earth's surface, then our fate is worst. Many meteorites are coming on Earth's surface every day, nothing to worry about it, but if it is having greater size, so for example, one meteorite of very huge size collide in Maharashtra, in Bulhana district, where you can find a lake that is called as Lonar Lake. The place you can search on Google Earth, there you can able to find out the place and you can able to get photograph of this place. So like that, many craters are formed because of this type of meteorite. They are reaching towards the Earth's surface. Now here, this is responsible for the ionosphere. Now let us check out again. We are dividing atmosphere into two parts, that is homosphere and heterosphere. Homosphere we are further dividing into troposphere, stratosphere and mesosphere, where composition is almost same, but ionosphere composition is different. So that is called as heterosphere. Ionosphere is in a range of say on 80 km onwards till 600 km, but the atmosphere exists towards outer side also, and all that part, no doubt, where it is a very rare atmosphere, but still atmosphere layers are formed. The outer jacket we are calling, that is we are calling as thermosphere, where temperature can be as high as 1400 degrees Celsius. Above 600 km we are calling the part, that is ionosphere only, but we are calling that as exosphere part, where outer part of exosphere, that is around 9600 km at higher altitude from Earth's surface. Now, outer part of exosphere we are calling as magnetosphere. But very little known about this, certain radiation belts are also. So like that, different parts of atmosphere, especially altitude wise, different parts we are going to discuss here. Now certain other data which is related with this, say for example you are aware of northern lights. If you have heard about northern lights, that from especially higher latitude we are having this type of light observed in sky during night time, especially one can observe, that is called as aurora borealis. Suppose you are able to observe this type of light in southern hemisphere, then it is called as aurora australis. So usually these lights are observed in sky, different colors from violet to green, different colors one can observe. This is probably because a charge, when sun is giving certain flares, charged particles are thrown away from sun surface. Part of that is able to enter in Earth's atmosphere. But Earth is also having magnetic field around it. And so, any charged particle is in motion, that is producing magnetic field around it. So they automatically get attracted towards North Pole and South Pole of Earth. And therefore, they get entered in the atmosphere, and probably in kilometer wise, 100 kilometer height, that means in particular to ionosphere and mesosphere region, they get discharged. Their charged particle, they are coming with very high velocity, and while entering, they give their energy to the gases present over here, and then light is produced. The excess of energy that is converted in form of light, and that's why we are getting this type of light, particularly from till 20 degree of magnetic pole. So if you are usually in the range of Arctic Circle, say Russia, Norway, Canada, like that countries, and Antarctic Circle near, then you can able to observe this type of light, that is called as aurora borealis in northern hemisphere, whereas aurora australis is in southern hemisphere. So particular this region where 100 kilometer height is there, this region is important. The lights are produced at that height and observed brightly from Earth. Obviously I have not visited that area, but on YouTube certain videos of this aurora borealis and aurora australis are there. You can just check out, you can get feel that what is the exact idea of these northern lights. I have to concentrate on insolation and heat budget. The first thing, what is insolation? So actually sun is radiating energy all over the surface of sun. But out of that, say for example this is sun, whereas energy is radiation in all possible direction, here because this is spherical in shape, whereas this is the size of Earth suppose. So only this much portion, if one can say, or rather in this way we can say from other parts, so only this much energy is able to receive on Earth surface. So that is total whatever the energy given out by sun, out of that 2000 million, you are aware of million, no? Million means what? I have to put into 10 to the power of 6. So only that much part of energy we are able to receive. So keep in mind, whatever energy is radiated by sun, out of that we are able to receive only this much energy. But whatever the total energy received on Earth, that we are calling as insolation. So from all these part of sun, whatever the radiations are coming to the Earth surface, that we are calling as insolation. Now, the thing is that atmosphere is not able to absorb long waves. short waves. So first we have to discuss what is long wave and short wave. For that purpose, there is one simple thing. You have to go to our physics lectures, the beginning lectures, where we have discussed about spectra. If you are aware of that, all right. Otherwise, just in short, I am giving you here. So try to recollect. Gamma rays are having shortest wavelength. After gamma, there is number of X. Then we are calling as vacuum ultraviolet. Then we are calling as ultraviolet. Then violet. So from violet to red. This range we are calling as visible range. After red, there is infrared, far infrared, then microwaves and radio waves. Usually, here, with this reference, we are calling these waves as long wave radiations and these waves as short wave radiation. So, sun is giving out almost all spectrum. Whereas, we are not able to receive all this in atmosphere. Atmosphere is not able to absorb all. So for example, you are aware that stratosphere is there. That is having ozone layers. So that is absorbing part of UV, not 100%, but part of UV is absorbed by that. So like that, different radiations are absorbed. Whereas gamma rays are having just range of 10 to 12 centimeter in atmosphere. So they get absorbed in upper parts of atmosphere. But remaining these short waves, they are not absorbed directly in atmosphere. Say gamma rays, X-rays, they are absorbed. But ultraviolet, not all. And visible range, not at all. They are just passed out till surface because they are, one can say, the atmosphere is not opaque for them. And therefore, these radiations are coming to the Earth surface. Now, when these radiations are coming out to Earth surface is absorbing them as well as reflecting them. Two things are carried out simultaneously. For example, the color of surface is very important here. One can say, suppose black soil is there, as we are calling of regur type of soil, that is having black color. So black color that indicate almost all radiations are absorbed. Whereas if you are talking of Himalayan part, particularly with India or ice caps present on North Pole and South Pole, then the radiations are reflected back because as that land is covered by ice and especially North Pole there is no land, there is only ice. So that is absorbed, that is reflecting out almost all radiations. I'm not telling you that that's why these regions are cold. Actually, the regions are cold, therefore there is ice. But because of this snowfall or ice cap, the radiations are reflected to greater extent. Whereas, that's why heating decreases because of this radiation. Land is absorbing. Say, whatever the percentage of, depend on color of land, the percentage of light is absorbed by land. Because of this absorption of radiation, land get heated, and that hot land now emit radiation, that is in form of this type of radiation we are calling this as long wave radiation. So keep in mind, any hot body definition is temperature should be greater than -273 degrees Celsius. If temperature of body is greater than -273 degrees Celsius, then we are calling that body as hot body. Try to recollect our space lectures, then we have discussed these type of substances. They are able to emit radiations, that is in range of IR, infrared. Usually we are calling thermal imaging. For thermal imaging also we are using the same radiation as infrared radiations. So this is the radiations emitted by this body. So -273 degrees Celsius, if temperature is greater than -273 degrees Celsius, then we are calling that as hot substance. So ice is comparatively very, very hot because ice is having temperature maximum in the range of 0 degrees Celsius. Now keep in mind that whenever this type of temperature, we are having temperature greater than -273 degrees Celsius, then that is capable of emitting this type of radiation. They are called as long radiation. Now, same way, land is also emitting this radiation, and atmosphere, particularly carbon dioxide, water vapor, methane, and other certain gases are there. They are able to absorb this long wave radiation. The result of this absorption of long wave radiation is that the substance, the atmosphere get heated. So keep in mind that there is warm weather or climate, or there is rising temperature of atmosphere. That is not because they are directly absorbing radiation. Instead of that, say this is land, this is layer of atmosphere, radiations are coming out like that. So because of radiation, this type of incoming radiation that we are calling as insolation. So because of insolation, the land is not going to become hot. But when this is absorbed by land and then reflected back in long wave, then that is absorbed in atmosphere. The gases responsible mainly, they are water vapors, carbon dioxide, and other gases like methane, etc. Keep in mind, many people are threatening because of greenhouse effect, and they are naming these gases as greenhouse gases. So one can reduce out pollution of carbon dioxide. This is very, very important fact, that one should reduce the pollution of carbon dioxide, that we can say yes, right. But how we can control our water vapors? At so many part of earth is covered by water bodies. We are calling this as hydrosphere. We are not having any control over this hydrosphere. And further, about the carbon dioxide emission, as a rise in carbon dioxide level is there, as well as we are having mechanism that decrease in carbon dioxide level is also possible. The water is best source that absorbs carbon dioxide. Water absorbs carbon dioxide and converted into carbonic acid. H2CO3 is formed. In sea, many part of that absorbed CO2 are precipitated, usually in form of say calcium carbonate. Like that, precipitation is also possible. So large amount of carbon dioxide is absorbed in seawater. So for global warming, it is not necessary that only greenhouse effect or like that carbon dioxide increasing proportion is required. Otherwise, certain questions are unanswerable here. Like we are having ice ages on Earth. Between two ice ages, there is certainly rising temperature. And for long ice ages, there was no evidence of human. And that's why we should not say that only man is responsible or these type of pollutants are responsible. For more detail, we can check out certain data, the rise in amount of carbon dioxide and rising temperature. From 1946 to almost 1975, the rise in carbon dioxide level was very high. But in this particular period, the temperature was decreasing. Can you call this as global cooling instead of warming? So not only we are responsible, as we are saying, that we don't have any control over this universe. We are having just control over certain parts of Earth, not 100% on Earth. And therefore, this type of discussion is actually not that much useful anyway. So this way, radiated gases, radiated heat is absorbed by this type of gases. Now, we have to talk of this thing. Say, whatever the insolation, insolation means light coming from sun, that is called as insolation. So whatever the insolation is there, how it is reflected back in the space. Let us check out the first thing. Whatever gases are present over there, they are reflecting out the instantaneous radiation. So 35% heat or 35% radiations are reflected back. Why 35% radiations are reflected back? Because of atmosphere. The second thing, you are aware that there is stratosphere which is consisting of ozone layer. Ozone layer is trying to absorb certain UV. Keep in mind, all UVs are not absorbed by that ozone layer, or that is called as ozonosphere. But harmful ultraviolet radiations are absorbed by ozonosphere. So because of that, there is rising temperature of atmosphere. That's why you will find that in case of stratosphere, temperature rises from almost minus 60 to 0 degree Celsius. The rise is of 60 degree Celsius. Now next part, that radiations are reaching towards Earth. Say 14% radiations are absorbed in atmosphere. So in short, one can say that 35% radiation get reflected back by atmosphere. Out of total insulation, 14% is absorbed by atmosphere. So just make out total, you will get 49. So now 49% are absorbed in atmosphere, whereas remaining amount, that is 51%, that 51% is reach out till Earth surface. Now Earth surface absorb all 51% and reflected back all 51%. Not directly, in form of long waves or short waves also. So whatever reflected back, out of that 17% is escaping to space. As 17% are unabsorbed by atmosphere, they are just pass out straight away to space, whereas 34% get absorbed by atmosphere. That means I should not use the word actually percent over here, but as we are saying 51%, consider that 51% only, then out of, or rather we can use the word unit. So suppose 35 units are reflected back, 14 units are absorbed, so total 49 units are absorbed. Then 51 units are reach at Earth surface, whereas out of that 51, the 17 units get absorbed by 17 units gets reflected back to the space, whereas 34 units get absorbed by atmosphere. So what is the total here again? 51 unit, that is the total that we are giving split. Now out of that 34 is, we have to add over here, because atmosphere is absorbing 14% and from insulation, and 34% from radiated by Earth. So total atmosphere is receiving 14 plus 34. So that gives total of 48. Now 48 units are reflected back in the space by atmosphere. Reflected back by atmosphere in the space. So here we are getting 48 units get reflected back from atmosphere. Now 35 units are reflected back by atmosphere, whereas the 17 units get radiated by Earth surface, that is also going in space. So the 52 units are given by space. Net total 48 plus 52, you are getting 100. So if 100 units are incoming, then 100 units are outgoing. And this way, the heat budget is called, because we are balancing out, say, whatever the radiations coming out, that means insulation, that is sent back to space. So this is basic idea, that whatever the sun is giving us energy, that energy is practically transferred again back in the space, and there is no rise and no fall in the temperature of Earth because of solar energy.